scripture reading is from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19, verses 11 through 13. I will be reading from the New Revised Standard Version Bible. Please listen to these holy words. He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of fear silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" A holy reading for the people of God.
Thank you so much, Peter, for reading those words. Well, I know I've told you a lot about me in the last year and a half, but there is something that I have been keeping from you. I have astigmatism. Does anybody in the room also have astigmatism? I have found my people. Okay. I am among fellow stigmatism sufferers. Now, astigmatism, if you don't have this, let me tell you what it is. It means that our eyes see two different planes of vision, and they are constantly working to bring those two planes into focus, to bring them together and to reconcile them so that you can see. Now, if you don't wear corrective glasses for astigmatism, your eyes get really tired really fast. You do know this about me, sometimes forget things. And so I always forget where my reading glasses are. And so I read a lot without them. And sometimes if you're reading, your eyes will almost kind of go cross-eyed. And sometimes it just gets so bad, you get a migraine or a headache, and you just quit. I mean, it is really, really hard sometimes to bring these two visions of focus into one. And so we are at the Book of Kings in our Bible year reading. And if you have started reading your Book of Kings, you'll see in your Bible it's 1 Kings and 2 Kings. This was originally one book, one manuscript writing. And if you, too, have been following along in these readings, if you didn't have astigmatism before this week, you might now, right? You might now. It is a lot. It's a lot of words, and there becomes this repetition of hearing about these kings of Israel. In fact, we hear about 40 different kings, and they're each evaluated for whether they were a good king over the Israelites or a bad king over the Israelites. And I hate to ever be a spoiler alert, but I'm going to. There's only 8 that make it to the good list that are getting presents from Santa this year. Everybody else is on the naughty list. In fact, they share this epitaph at the end of their legacy stories. King so-and-so, you may have read this week, did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all those who were before him. So not only do we get this repetition of Scripture, which remember, the repetition of Scripture is like a mother teaching a child. Don't forget this, right? But the repetition of Scripture here is warning us to not forget the power and evil and oppression and violence are systemic, and that they are hard chains to break. So here in the middle, and you don't even have to open your Bibles today if you don't want to. I'm not going to make you flip like I normally do a million times. It's a million different scriptures. You just have to listen this morning, which is good because somebody forgot their glasses. I won't point fingers. Janelle forgot her glasses. But as we are reading in these king stories, and we hear about all these 40 kings, and we seem to be stuck in this repetition of who was good and who was bad, we all of a sudden get an intercession of the story of two prophets. These aren't kings, so why are they included in the Book of Kings, and yet we understand so quickly that the Israelites need these prophetic voices? The first one that we are introduced to in 1 Kings, around chapter 16, is the prophet Elijah. Oh, Elijah is a wild man. He's kind of like a covenantal watchdog. I mean, when the Israelite leaders go off the rails and are leading the people poorly, he's just like, rah, 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 rah. Don't forget. Don't forget the covenant. Don't forget your God. Don't forget why you have been appointed to lead the people. But Elijah is leading during the time of King Ahab and his wife Jezebel. And it's old. Okay. If that name rings the bell, you might know which list King Ahab found himself on. It was not the good list. It was the naughty list. And so here, Elijah is one of the prophetic voices speaking to the Israelite people during the reign of one of the worst kings over Israel and his wife. In fact, they're not just bad leaders. They institute the worship of another god over the Israelites, the god of Baal. And in the institution of the god of Baal, who comes from Jezebel's family, there becomes a great drought in the land of Israel. People are suffering. In fact, Elijah gets sent to a widow's house during this great drought. And the widow has a son, and he's told to go to her house and ask for her to make him a cake and to give him some water so that he too can survive in this great drought and famine. And she tells him, this is the last meal that I have to make for my son. This is the last drop of water that we have. We were going to eat this meal tonight, celebrate our lives, and be done. And Elijah has the audacity to still have the meal. And he does so knowing that God's presence is going to come in abundance and sustain the life of this widow and her son. And God's presence does, and they're able to eat and they're able to drink. But the son still gets sick. He's been through a horrific famine. I can't imagine what he's done to his body if he has not been able to have food for so long. And so he dies. The widow is so upset. You came just to be here and watch my son die? And Elijah says, no, that's not why I come. And Elijah, out of his great and deep faith, cries out a prophetic prayer over this boy and restores his life. A beautiful testimony of the power that Elijah had. But Elijah's done. He's done watching people suffer because power has chosen a lesson. And so he goes to King Ahab and he says, it's time to choose. You cannot serve both Baal and Yahweh. And so in this epic, made-for-Hollywood movie scene, we watch him set up a test between the god of Baal and Yahweh. And he tells the prophets of Baal to set up a sacrifice and then call upon the Baal king to come and burn the sacrifice. He does the same. He creates a sacrifice for Yahweh, for the god of Abraham. And he is going to pray, but after they do it first. Because, you know, you always let... You always let the visiting team go first. And so the prophets of Baal start praying and praying and praying for Baal to show up and burn the sacrifice. And he's nowhere to be done. And so Elijah, I mean, y'all, seriously, he's a fierce watchdog for God. And he even not just calls upon God to show up and fire upon the sacrifice that he has put together, but he goes into pitchers of water and dumps them four times over the sacrifice. Just like, watch what my God will do, right? Watch what my God will do. And he prays afterwards that God's presence reigns, and suddenly we get this. Again, it is like made for Hollywood. This moment, I hope that you'll go back and read it this week. It's in chapter 18. But we get this moment where the presence of God comes down and engulfs not only the sacrifice, but the moat of water around it. I mean, it's a pure, pure exhibition of God's power and might. And in this moment, everybody who's there cannot deny who the true God is. Everyone there cannot deny what the God of Abraham has done. And yet, Elijah does something unexpected. Elijah calls for all of the prophets of Baal to be captured and he himself goes down to participate in their murder. He murders all of them. He kills all of the prophets of Baal. This, of course, incites rage within Jezebel, and all of a sudden we hear that Jezebel has sent out a warning among the people that she is coming for Elijah, and she will do to Elijah what he has done to the prophets of her God. And Elijah flees to the wilderness. We catch up with Elijah in the wilderness, lying beneath a broom tree. We catch up with Elijah, the great prophet, the fierce watchdog of the covenant, in the fetal position, curled up beneath a solitary broom tree. And when he goes to this moment, he pleads that God take his life. You see, Elijah has two planes of vision. The world as God has always meant it to be. And the way the world is changing. And Elijah has been trying all this time to bring these two planes of vision into one, to reconcile them together. And Elijah's eyes are also tired. And Elijah can't see it anymore. Elijah is giving up. So Elijah finally succumbs to his exhaustion. He falls asleep beneath the broom tree. The scriptures say that an angel comes to wake him with a cake and a cup of water and says, "Take, eat." He wakes up and eats. He falls back to sleep. An angel comes again with a cake and a cup of water and says, "Take and eat." Again, the motherly scriptures are reminding us to never underestimate the power of a good nap and a snack. They can restore us for the journey. So Elijah finally gets up from the broom tree and journeys on, it says 40 days and 40 nights, until he comes to, and this may sound familiar, Mount Horeb. It's the mount, if we remember, where Moses met with God and received the Ten Commandments. This is a mighty place. And Elijah goes to the top of the mountain and finds a cave with which to dwell. You see, Elijah is not okay. And Elijah finds himself in a mentally dark place. Elijah finds himself in a spiritually dark place, in an emotionally dark place, and now he's residing in a physically dark place. And this is where the scripture reminds us that it doesn't matter who you are, and it doesn't matter of what you have accomplished. When fear and despair and depression and anxiety and mental illness and regret come for you, it doesn't matter who you are. This is Elijah, the greatest prophet the Israelites have ever heard from, suffering beneath the weight of darkness in his own cave. Doesn't matter how big your Bible is, how strong your faith is, how important your profession is, or how loud your prophetic voice is, the darkness can and will come. But in the story of the kings of Israel, we continue to watch and wait. You see, when Elijah ends up in this cave, we hear the voice of God come to Elijah and ask this simple question, "Elijah, what are you doing here?" Now, this is where I think we need to be careful of some of the commentaries that we pick up and some of the biblical scholars with which we choose to read from, because I have read some that read this very different from my own lens. I've read some scholars who say that this is an accusatory moment of God upon Elijah, saying, why are you here? You're a prophet of the people, and here you are in a solitary, dark cave. Get back to work. What are you doing here?" I would ask that we for just a moment, because Elijah is not okay. Elijah's not okay. And God knows that. I wonder if you've ever met with a therapist or a counselor before. If you've ever walked in for the very first meeting and you have the butterflies in your stomach, like I always do if I'm meeting with a new counselor or a new therapist, and I sit down on that couch, you know, the one. Most of the times you hear the same question. Tell me why you're here. It's not an accusatory statement. My therapist isn't telling me to get back to work. My therapist wants to meet me in that moment with grace. My therapist wants me to hear the reasoning for how I have journeyed to this place where I am needing comfort. My therapist is there to be a friendly advocate for health and peace. I would ask that we wonder if God is doing the same in this text at this moment. Elijah, tell me why you're here. Elijah confesses before God about what's going on, and we hear something interesting in his confession. He not only says, they're after me, my life is in danger, but he admits that he may know the reason why. He says that he has been like his ancestors. He says that he has picked up the sword. You see, I think Elijah recognizes in this moment that though he has been a prophetic watchdog of the commandments, he himself is bound alliance in violence. Elijah, tell me what you're doing here. In this moment, we get the voice of the Lord comes to Elijah and says, I hear your confession. Now go and stand at the entrance of the cave because the Lord is going to be passing by. This time, we don't see Elijah curl into the fetal position and go and lie down back in the cool shade. We see Elijah go to the entrance of the cave to wait for the Lord to pass by. You see, Elijah is not okay, but Elijah does have hope. So at the entrance of the cave, we get these words that there was a great wind that came by, a destructive wind that came by, but God was not in the wind. And we hear that there was a massive earthquake. I can only imagine the fear that it incited, but God was not speaking in the earthquake. And then following the earthquake, there was a fire. And although God's presence had been evident in the fire over the sacrifice to defeat Baal, this time God is not in the fire. And then the scriptures say that there was nothing. Sound of sheer silence. Now, that's funny, right? Because silence is the absence of all sound. And yet, have you ever heard sheer silence before? It's deafening. At this moment, Elijah is met with the deafening sound of sheer silence. That's the sound that comes when we are finally able to turn all of the noise off. When we put down all the self-help books, when we close down the Facebook news feed, when we do not pick up the call to ask one more friend for their advice of what is happening in our own darkness. The sheer silence comes when we finally get to the place where we say, enough. We leave ourselves open to hearing from only God and only the truth that has always been with us. That truth that maybe we've been running from, truth that maybe we haven't wanted to admit, that truth that some part of us went off the rails, the truth that some part of us deny our calling, our faith, our purpose, and even our sacred divine. It's the sheer silence that brings that. It says that when Elijah heard the sheer silence, then he covered his face and went to the entrance of the cave. And again, hears these words, Elijah, what are you doing? This is the third time Elijah has been asked, what are you doing? I think this time God knows that Elijah has the ability to finally hear from himself. Remember who you are. Remember to whom you belong. Remember why you are here. If you've been to therapy, you know the therapist never gives to himself. The therapist always brings you to the place of hearing in your own voice. It's been within you the whole time. Finally, after this third confession from Elijah, God responds in a new way. God responds with a prophetic task. Elijah, go back. Go back to work. He gives him a couple of new leaders to state over the Israelites. He gets a new task. And in this moment, I don't want you to hear that God is giving him more work. God is recognizing that Elijah has spent enough time to get to a place of sheer silence, to recognize and remember who he is and to whom he belongs and to why he is here, that he believes within himself that he is ready to go back. I think this is a beautiful part of the scripture where God says, I recognize what you do. I saw you pick up the sword. But I know who you are. And I've got more work for you to do. And yet, he doesn't only get the job. He is told that as he goes back down and heads back to the people, to stop along the way and pick up a young disciple named Elisha. Yes, Elijah and Elisha. He is granted help. You see, God hears our cries. God understands when we're not okay, and God sends help. Elijah and Elisha will go from this place and continue to do great things. They will continue to depend on and call upon the presence of God among the people. In fact, they said that Elisha has twice the strength and might of Elijah, the first prophet, and he goes on to do twice as many wonders and works. But the thing is that even though Elisha does twice as much as Elijah does, until there's this moment where Elijah has an ascension into heaven. It's incredible. It's a glorious story. You're going to be reading it later this week in your text. And in fact, it's why, as our Jewish brothers and sisters celebrate the Seder meal next week during Holy Week, they believe that the prophet Elijah is to come back before the Messiah, is to return as an ushering in of the Messiah's reign upon the earth, and that they will leave an empty seat and an open door at the Seder meal for the return of Elijah. You see, even though Elisha had twice as much power and seems to have done the job better than Elijah, do you know what happens in our New Testament scripture as we get to the week before Jesus enters into Jerusalem? You see, there's a text that tells us about a transfiguration moment where Jesus too goes up to the top of the mountain because he's afraid. He goes to the top of a mountain because he knows what's coming and he's fearful. And do you know who he meets with? Moses and Elijah. how heavy a burden and a weight it is to have spiritual astigmatism. Where you walk around seeing two visions of the world, the one that God has always intended and the one that is promised to be coming and returning to us, and the way that it is and how tiring it is to try and get those into one plane vision and to reconcile what we see all around us. Elijah knows. And I wonder, I just wonder, we don't have recorded within our New Testament scripture what is said between Elijah, Moses, and Jesus. The disciples that end up writing about the account are too far away from this moment. They just see the three holy of holies dancing in conversation together. And I wonder if Elijah maybe says to Jesus, Jesus, what are you doing here? Jesus. Reconnect with the truth within himself, to remember who he is, to whom he belongs, and to why he has been saved. I wonder if Elijah, a former wrestler in the darkness, opens up that space for Jesus to be truly present, to find comfort that in our suffering we are heard, and that in our suffering we are granted help, and that in our suffering we are never alone. It's the same question that God asks of each and every one of us. When you find yourself in the dark cave of whatever is going on in your life, might you hear these words? Oh, sweet child of mine, what are you doing here? And may you be willing to enter into the sheer silence of being present in that moment with God. That you might remember the truth of his revealing. This morning, as we close in prayer, I am quick to admit that even clergy find themselves in dark days. Even clergy find themselves wondering, what am I doing here? So this morning, I want to close with a prayer written by my friend Kate Bowler so that I too can hear these comforting words. Let us pray. Oh God, I am so tired. Each breath is shallow. My strength has melted away and hope is hidden behind a wall. I don't even want to call out of bed. I feel alone. The parenting, the endless to-dos, the juggling too much, the spread too thin. Oh God, I cry out to you from the ends of the earth. Show me how this works. How you bring dry bones to life. Help me. Blessed are we, the weary and weak and sore, with only the merest ember left burning, but who still say, breathe on me. Breathe life into my tired body, my heavy limbs. Bring light to the dark corners of my mind. Breathe comfort into my sad heart. Blessed are we who turn our gaze to seek the one who truly sees us and knows us, like newborns whose bleary sight focuses to find adoring eyes beaming down, delighting and filling, mirroring and multiplying. Blessed are we who discover that we are